This is the introduction to Apache Kafka about consumers. Now, consumers are the client components outside of the cluster responsible for reading data from Kafka topics and ideally doing something with it. So using the consumer API is very similar in principle to using the producer that we covered in the last module. And again, we'll be doing Java in these examples. In Java, you use a class called Kafka Consumer to connect to the cluster. You give it that same map of key value pairs, the properties file that's got the configuration. We show here just the bootstrap servers. In real life, there could be 5 or 10 of these for this, that, and the other thing, you know, some security settings and things. At a minimum though, you at least need to point the consumer to the cluster so it knows what brokers to try to access to be able to read the rest of the metadata about the cluster. As we explained in the section on producers, you don't need to give it the full list of all the brokers. That would probably be inconvenient. It just needs enough that one of those will be up and available. It'll be able to talk to that one and learn what it needs about the whole cluster. And with that, we connect to the Kafka cluster with the Kafka consumer object. Once we've got that, we need to give it a list of topics to subscribe to. Well, what if you only want to subscribe to one topic? What if you don't want a list? That's okay. You just use a list of one thing. That subscribe method needs to take a list, and so you give it a list of one thing. And for the stout-hearted, that can also be a regular expression that subscribes to all topics that match the regex. That's possible to do if you want to do that. I'm not saying you should, I'm just saying you can. After we've subscribed to one or more topics, we enter an infinite loop. Maybe you're not used to that, you think that's kind of a bad thing. Here, it's perfectly fine. If you think about it, this event-driven code, this is what you do forever. You read messages from the topic. There is no last message. The idea of a last thing is kind of batch-oriented thinking. This is streaming data, so there's always more of it. So we call this poll method that tells the library to go and ask the cluster whether there are any new messages for it to consume. Now, deep under the hood of the consumer library, that method is aware of which partitions are implicated, so which topics are we subscribed to, what partitions does that topic have, where are the leaders, what brokers have the leader partition for each of the partitions in the topic. So this really is asking specific computers in the Kafka cluster, specific processes out there, whether they've got any new messages. When they do, we get back a collection called consumer records, and that is a generic type in Java. You see the angle brackets and string. That means that we're saying the type of the key is a string and the type of the value is a string. That's just like what we produced. You want those types to match what you're producing. Now, string isn't a terrible type for a key. Often you have primitive types like string or int or long or something like that for the key. The value, usually that's some kind of domain object. You've modeled that in the type system of your language. There is, in data terms, a schema there, and that schema matters. We're covering that up for now. We're just trying to get the ideas into our heads and really look at what the code looks like in its simplest form. We're going to add some schema to that in a little bit. We get that collection of consumer records and we can iterate over that. It might just be one record. We could get many records back. If this is a high traffic topic, there could be many of them waiting for us. So we iterate over that. And you see here, what we're most interested in is the key and the value, the message itself. And in this genius little bit of computation, we are logging them to the console. It's okay if you want to use this code, go ahead. It's free. You could just copy it and use it. Now there's more in there than just key and value, and you can see that in the docs. You can know things like what partition did this come from, what's the timestamp, all kinds of other little bits of metadata. The headers, if you want to know the headers, but key and value are usually in first place. Those are things that you really need to know. But you know, there's a bigger story in consumers than just the network plumbing. They're a lot more interesting. Let's talk through some of it. As a reminder, Kafka is not a queue, it's a log. A topic is fundamentally a log, which means that the act of consuming doesn't make messages go away. We can have these two independent consumers reading the same message. When consumer A reads it, consumer B can still come along and read it. Consumer C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, L, M, N, O, B, any of those, however many consumers you have, they can all read those same messages. So very, very important. Some of you might be wondering at this point, what happens if the consumer goes away? Like, okay, everybody can read independently, but what if a consumer dies and then you restore it? How does it know where it was? Well, on a periodic basis, a consumer basically reports back to the cluster the most recent offset it's consumed. And this is called consumer offset tracking or consumer offset commits, because the act of the consumer telling the cluster is called a commit. Now, those offsets are stored in a special purpose internal topic. So Kafka kind of uses Kafka to build this Kafka functionality. It's pretty cool. But that consumer there, as you can see, will read one, will read two, and then three didn't work. So it doesn't commit the offset three there back to the cluster. And maybe you'll restore it, it'll try again, whatever the recovery is. So when it does properly process number three, it commits that offset. This is a little more complicated in the actual details. A consumer doesn't necessarily commit every single offset it consumes. That could be pretty expensive. They're usually batched up and there's some threshold, like a certain number of commits or a certain amount of time after which it will commit those offsets back to the cluster, all documented and available for your optimization if that's a thing that you need to dive into. Now, consumers can scale. They form what are called consumer groups. So right here, I've got consumer A and this three partition topic. So when consumer A is reading messages from that topic, they could come from any of the three partitions, and it can only really be processing one at a time. Consumers are fundamentally single-threaded things. And of course, hey, I could have consumer B. And what does consumer B do? Well, consumer A is reading messages. Consumer B is reading messages. And A and B are operating independently, but they're both single-threaded, just one message from one partition at a time. What if I can't quite keep up with the work? Say the processing that consumer A does is more expensive. There's more work to do, maybe external services to interact with or something like that. And we need to parallelize that work. Well, what we do is we simply add more instances of that application. And that's literally the case. So if this is, say, a Java process, there's a JVM process running on an instance, make a new instance, run that same exact Java process, same program. If it's a Docker image in Kubernetes, make another instance of that so that the cluster will spin that up. And that program running a second time connects to the Kafka cluster. It's got the same consumer group ID. And Kafka will say, oh, okay, I see what's going on here. This is a consumer group. I'm going to assign partitions like you see on the slide. Now, when A consumes, each one of those consumers can consume from its own partition. And they run in parallel because they're separate processes. Consumer B is still stuck going one at a time. And maybe that's all consumer B needs. But consumer A has got more processing bandwidth and some fault tolerance. If one of those goes away, well, what's going to happen? The cluster will work with the consumer group to reshuffle partitions, and that middle partition, partition one, will be assigned to that remaining instance. And now it has to do double the work. Hopefully it can keep up, but I'm sure someone is getting paged and is busy restoring that failed instance of consumer A. So that's it for our introduction to consumers. Of course, like everything else, there is so much more detail to pursue, more advanced tutorials, more stuff in the documentation. Dig into that as you need to. And this is another thing, like I said in the case of the producer, a good time to get your hands on some code, see how this stuff works in the language of your choice with an actual cluster that you can interact with.